I don't consider myself lacking structure because there is a structure to my lack of structure. There is a method to my lack of method, and it's not always madness. When I have a computer, I was always told, hey, get a computer, you'll dig it. But the technology of computers just kept me away. I'd rather just do it that way. But then I found out, wow, if you just learn some of the rules, instead of me getting drunk and calling 25 people to hear a new poem I wrote, which is going to cost me a hell of a lot of money, I can write that poem now on the computer and send it out to 25 or 100.
Is that a frequent time in your youth?
Yes. During my drinking time, when I would write some poetry by myself, and I would call everybody I know and say, you got to hear my latest poem. And I'd call people 3, 4, 5 in the morning. And a lot of them were tolerant and understood. But now that I'm sober, I don't do it. And if I even have to do it, they're very touchy. But if I'm drunk, they accept it. So I don't know. Go figure.
Or desk?
I have a desk. I live in a very small space. Originally, it was so that nobody would want to move in with me because I really like my privacy and my solitude. Although as age is creeping up my back, I find I'd like somebody to help me wash the dishes and help me prepare dinner and stuff.
Describe to me the organization of your desk.
Well, I have two computers. I have a Dell laptop here and a Mini Mac here. And then I've got this thing with papers that I write lots of notes and they're all over and I never know where poems are going to go. But it's kind of Freud. When patients went to Freud, he kept the office in disarray. It relaxed the patient. So I don't know if I have any of that going on with myself, but when I'm working, I just want to know where things are, but they don't have to be neat and shiny.
If you walk into a girlfriend's house and all the closets are color coordinated and everything has its spot, does that create anxiety for you?
I think that would interfere with our communications. She'd expect the same of me, and I can't be her color or her design or anything.
Has that ever happened? Can you describe a situation?
Just recently got in touch with an old girlfriend, and she came to town, and I realized I have things hanging from my ceiling, and this girl, she's got a big Cadillac with Dr. Patty on there. Her first name was Patty, Dr. Patty. Everything is clean and neat and nice. When I knew her, she was a little looser. We met in acting class, I was even going to call her after it, but I thought, you know, when she told me who she voted for, and I saw the car and the name, I just figured, you know, that's out. Because I was wondering how, she was an actress who became a television news person, and that now she's got a PhD in education and she's at a leading university nearby. I thought it would be interesting to rekindle, or at least a friendship. But after I saw how she looked and how I'm sure she didn't fit into my environment, it would be a waste of time. In answer to the question, has anyone ever been appalled at my where I live? My mother has, and my sister has at times. Anybody else who has, I would just hope that they don't have to come back again. But most of the people like it. They say, this is like an art gallery. This is like a museum, because I have just pictures of different people. They're all surprised at who I know. About religion is that I really don't think God is a he or a she. I don't think God has a beard or stands to urinate. I think God is probably something most people can't fathom, so we have to do it in a storybook way. I think God is some kind of energy, and I don't know what our ethics have to apply to getting into heaven, although if you're cruel to your fellow, you're cruel to God's creation. As far as sexual stuff, a lot of my friends are very heterosexual. I'm heterosexual, but I also understand that if you're born gay, nobody's going to twist your ear and make you straight. And why should they hate you and beat you up and do stuff like that? That's absurd to me. And I have to tell people when I write. I mean, one guy was just discharged from the army dishonorably because he admitted he was gay. That guy speaks Arabic. We could well use his services for this country, and any idiot who got rid of him shouldn't be in such a position.
Now, this screams to me that you want other people to listen to you.
Yep.
would you describe yourself as obnoxious, opinionated, arrogant, or just right?
All of the above. They don't mean well.
This seems to be a good expression of your... If someone says you're wrong, do you feel obliged to get in their face and tell them?
In some cases, or I sort of say, can we sit down and discuss this? Because I can prove that what I say has merit, and your position is totally wrong. this car relates to me because I think we have the right to free speech in this country, and if we don't use it, we're going to lose it. So I just want to make sure that I'm using it and that I can tell other people, be brave. Tell the politicians you vote for, if we don't like what you do, you'll get an eviction notice from us and not be reelected. Otherwise, do what's right. As long as you do what's right for the people of this country, you can't go wrong. Once you take money from somebody else, you're serving two masters and you suddenly become a prostitute. You're no longer an honored statesman, which is what politicians should become as they age. So I do it as best I can. I think everybody should make that same contribution.
Maybe. At least he's definitely sporadic and unorganized. Would you agree? He thinks there's structure to his non-structure. Lack of methodness, yeah. So I mean, he has a little delusion. Now, did you understand the political references? So his car actually has anti-George Bush bumper stickers. And what you may not have noticed is that literally every section of paint is written on a slogan or a lie by George Bush. But I think it's really great so that you know that all Americans don't think like George Bush, for sure. I also found that, you know, the handwriting looks pretty neurologically unorganized. He sort of admitted he was an alcoholic since age 10, up to age, what, 45, 50? That's a lot of alcohol in your bloodstream. He's still alive? Yes, but the alcohol is okay. He stopped drunk dialing as much. Yes, sir. Yes. What did I say? He's suicidal? No. Yeah, he's very original. He's very great. He's eccentric. Yeah, he's eccentric. Brynn thought she was eccentric. Brynn needs to meet Rigg. Hello, this is eccentric. I mean, you would have to think Rigg is on the better side of his life now that he's not drinking and all the things that he did. But I think self-destructive would probably be part of his past. I mean, he sure didn't look stable by any means. I mean, you don't drive around in that car and not expect people to, you know, yell or react. I mean, there's a certain amount of social obnoxiousness that he actually gets pride from. So whether it's self-destructive, I'm not sure. Clearly, drinking and knowing you're an alcoholic for 40 years is a destructive activity. So I think you're probably accurate. I think the only thing that surprised me was that we had a really vivid example of his sporadic brain. Most people that would be that unorganized would not have a car that was that sporadic and unorganized. I mean, he wrote random sentences on his car. That is such an outlandish thing to do. I mean, who writes with a marker on their automobile? It absolutely breaks every rule. Does it make sense? And it screams at every penny passing by, you're wrong, I'm right, you're stupid, I'm not. So, I mean, it really was a great example of what we see in his writing of having no rules and no structure and no respect for authority. He really elaborated that. That we got correctly. I think what I didn't get correctly is I actually underestimated his intelligence. He seemed like a pretty bright guy.